Corner. You are now live. Remember to mute the stream. Okay, so that should pop up in, I don't know, a couple of seconds. And are we live? We are. Hooray. All right. So you want to wait 1 minute and kind of see if a few people show up?
Yeah, that's probably good.
All right, cool. So if you guys are around, feel free to comment in the chat. That would be awesome. And I'll put this on social real quick. Why is that full screen? Ew. All right. So Christian's the one that's good at all this stuff. I've never done the interview side of it, so this is going to be a work in progress for me.
I'm sure we can make some interesting conversation happen.
Something tells me that. Based upon our normal conversations, I'm assuming we can do it again today. We are finally live. At SplitSuit and at Dr. Tricia Cardner. On Twitch. And I need that URL. As soon as we do that, we are rocking. And add a photo. Twitch. We're finally live. Excellent. All right, so that just went off. If you want to retweet it, I'll retweet it on my side as well.
Ready?
Boom, boom, boom. This is so much easier to do when you have a spotter.
Yeah, I agree.
All right, and I'll answer all my Twitter stuff later. All righty. So I don't know when people are coming in, but you know how this goes. People just show up randomly.
Got it.
All right, cool. So you ready to get started?
Let's go.
All righty. So this is where Christian would normally take his sweet time and introduce you to the world and talk about what Red Reports are. So Red Report is something that Christian Soto started, and the goal is to interview some awesome people in the poker community and not really talk so much about hardcore strategy, but really to focus more on the lifestyle and interesting people in the poker community. So today's guest is Dr. Tricia Cardner. So Dr. Tricia Cardner, please introduce yourself.
Well, it's hard to follow up, you know, the work that Christian does, because he usually comes up with so many interesting things. But
true.
I'm Dr. Tricia Cardner. I'm the author of Positive Poker, along with Jonathan Little. And I make interesting mental game videos over at Red Chip Poker. And I'm podcasting with Elliot Rowe. So I've got all kinds of things going on.
You do. And we're going to talk all about those in a lot of detail. And before we really get into kind of the work and the content that you've created, both at RedChip and other places, why don't you first start by talking about what you were doing before poker? So what was your path leading up to poker?
Well, that's a really good question. And it's going to have a really long answer unless I get really good at editing.
That's okay.
I've done a lot of things, but I've always been really interested in psychology. I mean, I can remember being, you know, very young, like 5 years old, and just wondering like why people did what they did and just what makes people tick and all that sort of thing. So I guess I was a weird kid in that respect. But as I grew up and got older, like in middle school, I did the Dear Abby of the school newspaper. And then once I got to high school, I got to take a class in psychology. And, you know, like I already knew that I loved it, but like that really sealed the deal.
Sure.
So I, you know, like most people, I went to college, except for there is one thing that a lot of people don't know about me. So you know how sometimes they'll say, oh, what's five things that people don't know about you?
Sure.
Well, this is one. I actually did not finish high school. And I have a GED, and I always like to say I went from GED to PhD in 5 easy steps, but I actually went to college without a GED or high school diploma. I got like this special permission to go.
How'd you get that? You test into it or?
No, I walked. I had a college catalog, and I read in there that you could get the special permission of the dean. It was like a special approval to go to college. And I was like, oh, this seems like a good thing to do.
Sure.
And for a variety of reasons, I didn't finish high school. I mean, I do not recommend people take this path, but for me personally, I just wanted to get on to college, quite honestly.
Sure.
So I went to the dean and I said, hey, I see you can give me the special approval. And he just readily agreed to it. So I didn't have the GED. And he said, sure, come on in, go to the testing center, take the ACT, just, or SAT, whatever it was, so we can place you. And there you go. So I
Awesome.
ended, say
I said awesome. And that
again.
was in Texas, right? You grew
Yes,
up in Texas?
in Texas.
Okay.
I know they'll do anything in Texas, right? It's just crazy people. But actually, I ended up going to this college. This was a junior college, community college. And I did the 2 years and I was about to transfer to a senior college and I still didn't have a GED. And I was like, well, maybe I should go take it. So I did right before I switched. So my GED graduation date and my bachelor's degree are really close together.
Nothing wrong with that. And what did you study in college then? So that was psychology as well?
I majored in psychology as an undergraduate, of course. Well, like, what else is there for me? And I was working all through college over at the local, at the time, I don't know if it's they're still called this, but it was the MHMR, which stood for mental health, mental retardation. And obviously that word is not PC any longer. But that's what it was called in those days. And I worked with chronically mentally ill clients. So they all had like schizophrenia, bipolar, things like that. And I loved it because, it was just so interesting to me.
Did that help prepare you for working with poker players or?
Well, I mean, not really. I mean, that was chronically mentally ill. So, from there, I went to graduate school, of course, and I started working with offenders, mostly juvenile offenders, but then I graduated to adult offenders and primarily sex offenders,
Okay.
which was really interesting. And you
Sure.
might say, well, does that relate to poker? Oh, I'm not sure, but
I figured I'd stop pushing that question.
Well, so then what happened is because I was working with offenders and I was like, oh my God, like these people are, they're just so different and they think in such a different manner. So that's what got me going down like the criminology rabbit hole. So I started going down that rabbit hole and I got a doctorate in criminology.
Excellent.
And yeah,
And did you do the education all the way through, or was it broken up between chunks of work and then back to school, work and then back to school, or was it education the entire way through?
it was work the entire way through.
Okay.
When I was in graduate school, I worked from 7:30 to 4:30, and then I went to school. It just so happened that in that program, I was at Texas Tech. Our classes were in the evenings, and so I would go like at 5 o'clock, and then I would go from 5 to 10 p.m. was class basically. So yeah, that was my life. I've always worked.
Sure.
So yeah,
Jeez, good
and.
for you.
Then when I started on my doctorate, I did a lot of like research fellowships, but quickly, very quickly, I became a teaching fellow and I started teaching. Because by the time I was working on my doctorate, I was already a licensed professional counselor and I had a lot of clinical experience. And so even though I was in a criminology program, they offered a lot of different types of classes. And so I ended up teaching the psychology classes,
Okay.
which was nice. But I knew, I was like, I'm not gonna work for the rest of my life in criminology with like criminals.
Sure.
That's no fun. And you're not going to cure them. So
Really what it is? There's just no cure. I mean, I don't know too much about that. Is there really no curing for it? Is it just kind of like subduing the behavior or?
mean, it's just that's such a tough question to answer because it really depends on, so many factors, but I would say with a lot of the juveniles that I worked with, they were not going to continue on and become hardcore criminals just because most people in their juvenile years do stupid things, which are criminal.
Sure.
But they're not going to be hardcore criminals. But then the people, the small percentage of the juvenile group that is going to come on, go on and become criminal, a lot of times, you know, they get hardened into the system and they get socialized and then it's just down from there.
Gotcha.
So it's just difficult because you're looking at all the, you know, psychological factors plus all the sociological, you know, like even if you go to the penitentiary, when you come out, how are you going to get a job and you're back in the same neighborhood and, you know, it's just all that stuff.
Sure. Yeah, totally makes sense. So you decided that criminology wasn't the path you wanted to go down. Where did we go next?
That was like a detour. Well, when I came out of that doctoral program, I took a, I was a professor of psychology. Mm-hmm. So that was nice. And I, you know, of course I already have my license. I got my license with my master's degree. And so then I was like, you know what? I got to go back to, my roots. I got to get back into psychology. And then I thought, you know, I've kind of worked with the worst of the worst in many ways. So I like to work with the best of the best. And so that's what got me into peak performance psychology, sports psychology, you know, all those sorts of things. Like, what does it take to be just, you know, great in whatever your endeavor is?
Sure. So what did you say you focused in sports first?
Sports psychology, peak performance psychology. I would say my dissertation really is, could be classified as a sports psychology dissertation. In that one, it was, what was it called? It was called Peak Poker Performance, a Qualitative Case Study.
Interesting. So, can you give a little bit of detail about that?
Well, I had this bright idea because by this time I had gotten into poker, and we can talk a little bit later about, you know, exactly how I got into poker. But by the time I was working on the second doctorate and writing this dissertation, I was already into poker. And remember, I had done a dissertation for the first one. Mm-hmm. And so I really wanted to do something, you know, fun that I was into. So I went to my chair and I said, hey, I want to do a poker dissertation, and basically it's going to be sports psychology because it's super common in sports psychology for them to do research where they say, look at Olympic athletes or world champions.
Sure.
So, something of that nature. So I was like, I want to look at poker players. And of course my chair said, no, absolutely not. You're not doing that. And I was like, I will do this. I will make it this happen. But anyway, His father, as I understand it, had been a compulsive gambler.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had like some real issues around just gambling in general.
For sure.
But I was like, you know, I'm not looking at it from that angle. And why don't you, you know, watch some poker? So I kind of, you know, turned him on to some televised poker, like the World Series and the WPTs and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, just see what you think. And if you're like completely against it, we'll scrap this whole idea. And, you know, but if you look at it and see what I see, which is that while, yes, people could have some sort of gambling problem, but on the other hand, most poker players are extremely bright. They're not, you know, just gambling. They look at it as a challenge. And I felt like it just had a lot more in common with, say, games like chess.
Sure.
So he watched and then he came back to me and he was like super excited. And he was like, I see what you mean. And I was like, I knew that you would. and so I ended up interviewing. At the time, it was only tournament players really, because you have to have some sort of way to justify that these people are champions.
Sure.
And you can do it if you can get like their tournament winnings. And, you know, everybody had to have over $1 million in tournament winnings. And I know that for us in the poker community, we know that's not necessarily a sign of, you know, greatness per se.
Exactly.
But for research purposes, it'll do. It has to be done. So
right.
What I did is I interviewed up a number of people and I promised them all anonymity, but I assure you that these are big names that if I were allowed to say their names, everybody who's listening right now would say, oh, I know those people. And she did a good job of picking people.
Mm-hmm.
I think. And so I just ask a whole lot of questions about the mental game and how they worked on their mental game and what parts of the mental game were important to, you know, achieving success and, you know, all those sorts of questions.
For sure. So what did you end up finding at the end? Because obviously a dissertation usually has some sort of general thesis, right?
Well, yes, that is true. This was a qualitative study because at the time, I think this was like 2011, people had not really been doing as much serious scientific work with poker players as what you see now.
Mm-hmm.
So when I did like the review of the literature, there was really nothing on, you know, what it takes to be a great poker player in the psychological literature.
Sure.
There were a few things coming out in math. And, you know, a little bit in the law journals, but like really nothing in psychology. So basically the questions were, what psychological skills, traits, and abilities do these players have that are contributing to their success?
Mm-hmm.
Well, do they have them? And what are they, basically? And then I used, this is probably going to bore people, okay? But
I'm very excited about this. I'm a huge nerd, though, so please go on.
I used a particular way of what you have to do is you have to transcribe everything out. And I use something called In Vivo, which is kind of a complicated piece of software. But what it helps you do is it helps you take all those transcriptions and you're looking for patterns and you're looking for, you know, are people saying the same things, even, you know, though they say it differently.
Mm-hmm.
So it's quite a lot different than a quantitative dissertation, which was what my first one was. So I've done a quantitative, which is straight number crunching. And then I did the qualitative. And just for people who may wonder about this, if you're thinking about getting a doctorate in the social sciences, I always have or had, because I don't teach anymore, but I would have students say, oh, I want to do a qualitative one because they think it's easier because they think, well, the quantitative has all the math.
Mm-hmm.
I've done both, and I'm here to tell you the quantitative is easier.
Really?
So there you have it.
All right. Fair enough.
You know how it is. When you crunch the numbers, you get an answer.
Right.
Right?
Exactly.
It is what it is. But when you do qualitative, you have to do a lot of interpreting, and there's just, you know, a lot of room for disagreement and, you know, all that sort of thing. So I personally think the qualitative is harder.
For sure. Okay. That totally makes sense. So did you get into poker before you did the dissertation or
yes.
did you get into it after? Okay. So how far before, like how, what kind of piqued your interest into poker in the first place? And then what made you want to actually do this in an academic setting when you were kind of like pioneering it because it really hadn't been done yet?
Well, like most people, you know, I didn't grow up playing poker or anything like that, but I had an opportunity to go live in Cheyenne, Wyoming.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing against the good people of Cheyenne, Wyoming, but there's not much to do there. And so this was about 2006.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the poker boom was in full bloom then. And so my husband was in the military. He was in the Air Force. So I'm going to have to give a shout out to the 319th Squadron. And they had a little home game. And I never played cards in my life. But what else am I going to do in Cheyenne? Okay.
Exactly.
So they invited me to come to the home game and I came and I didn't know anything. And we bought him for like $20. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And we played and I guess it was sort of like a tournament, but not exactly. I don't think they really knew what they were doing. Okay.
Right.
But immediately I was like, hey, this, it has like everything. It has the math, it has the psychology. It just, like has so many interesting nuances to it, you know?
Sure.
Yeah. So 100%. I don't know if I should admit this or not, but me and my husband were just talking about this the other day.
Mm-hmm.
He had bought, and I don't know when he bought it, and he couldn't remember either when or where or whatever, but he had one of Phil Hellmuth's books. And it was the one that was like, you're either an eagle or an elephant or whatever, lions, I can't remember all of it.
Right.
But that was the only poker book that we had in the house. And so I read about, I don't know, like 30 pages out of it. And then I was like, nah, threw that away. But
so that was your first poker book.
Yes. Do not tell Phil Hellmuth I said that, okay?
I will not, I promise. So you got kind of into the game. Where did you go from there? So you read a couple pages of Hellmuth's book and then knew better to put it down. Where did we go from there?
Okay, so I said to my husband, I want to go to Las Vegas. And I don't know why I said this, okay? Because I'd only played a few times in the basement and read like 30 pages of Hellmuth's book. But I just had this idea. I wanted to go to Las Vegas. And I wanted to, I know you're going to think I'm the craziest person. I wanted to go play at Binion's because that's where the World Series had started.
Right.
So my husband humored me and we went to Binion's and they had a little tournament going. And I think it was probably about $100 buy-in. And we bought in. And actually the players there, especially compared to me and my level, they were good. Okay, mm-hmm. I'm not saying they were world class, but compared to my three times in the basement, they were good. So, but I did end up cashing, and I think I finished maybe like top 15, maybe like in 14th or 15th place, something like that. Oh my God, you would have thought I won the lottery. Like, I have my money, and it wasn't even a lot of money, okay? I mean, I don't know what you get for a $100 tournament when you finish in like 14th or 15th, but whatever it was, right?
$140, maybe?
I don't know. I mean, I'm trying to remember, and I cannot remember. It was a pretty good-sized tournament, I will say that, in terms of, I bet it was like maybe 250 people or something.
Okay. It's not bad at all for...
Yeah, not so bad, right?
No, okay, not
but
at all.
Just because I had the bragging rights, though, because my husband also played in it, and he busted in like the first hour, just saying. So then I've conquered Binion's, okay? And I'm just kidding, people. I know I didn't really. But, you know, I said, okay, here's what. I want to go over to the Venetian. Now, you're going to think this is really crazy. I wanted to go over there, and I wanted to play cash. Mm-hmm. And the reason I wanted to go play cash is because, and this is going to sound so stupid to people, but our vacuum cleaner had like exploded. Mm-hmm. And I was like, it would be so fun to get the money from poker to buy a new vacuum cleaner.
Excellent.
So we go over to the Venetian and I remember it so well because it was my birthday, in fact. And I sat down at the 1-2 table with whatever, like, the minimum you could buy in for. I can't remember now what it was, but whatever, which was a terrible idea. But I don't know any better. What do I know?
Right, exactly.
And I lose down to, like, $25. And my husband came to my table, and he's like, how are you doing? And I was like, not very good. I've only got, like, $25. And I really wanted that vacuum. So I told him, I go, it's okay. I'm going to do it. I'm going to put my nose to the grindstone and I'm really going to do it. So I sat down with my $25 and I run it up to about $350. Mm-hmm. And I knew that $350 would buy me my Kenmore vacuum cleaner. So I jumped up from the table and I was like, I got my money for my vacuum. And I went and I traded it in and I went to Sears. We went to the Sears in Cheyenne, Wyoming, and we got a vacuum, which we still have today, people.
That is fantastic. The greatest getting started in poker story ever.
Well,
so did you start playing online at all? Or did you just make the occasional trips out to Vegas and then continue doing the basement game? Like, where did it kind of go from there?
Well, in the basement game, I mean, of course, we had to continue with our basement games, right? But I knew, of course, once I came back from that weekend where I had just really torn it up, I was like, you know what? I really need to start studying. Like, really, I need to learn this game. And, you know, I need to, like, straighten up and do some things. So mm-hmm. one of the guys in the basement, I guess that's okay if I shout his name out, right?
Sure.
His name is Will Boyd. So hi, Will, if you're watching. But I would always call him Will Muth, like gotcha. Wilhelm Muth, right? Mm-hmm. Because when he would bet, like if everybody else was betting a quarter, he would bet a dollar. So I would call him Will Muth. But anyway, Will Muth told me that you could play online. Mm-hmm. And I was like, that's the craziest thing I ever heard. And he was like, no, you really can. And I think at the time you could still play on like party poker. Mm-hmm. But although I never played on party poker, I went straight to, and I'm sorry, people, I apologize for this. I went straight to Full Tilt and that's where I played. And yeah.
So. That's okay. There are worse sites. At least we got our money back, right?
I did get my money back. It hasn't been that long ago. I think I actually got it. It was during this summer that I got it back.
Wow.
Yeah. I did get my money back.
Yeah. Just, you know, they gathered interest on it for a few years, but whatever. What are you going to do?
I mean, whatever. At least I wasn't like I had seven figures locked up on there anyway. I had like four figures, so it wasn't like huge, but it
wasn't that bad.
It was nice to get it back, though.
For sure, right? Free money. I had written that money off, so it was always nice to get it back.
Especially, I got mine in June, so I was at the series. And when I saw that I had a little extra in my bank account, I was like, hey, what is this? And then I checked, and it was like, well, I can't remember what it said, but it was something official, you know, like DOJ or something. I don't know what it was, but.
Yeah, exactly.
I was like, oh, I got my full time money.
So did you take online serious? Was it just like a training ground for you? Like what was online play for you?
I think it was because I was working obviously full time. So it wasn't like I was a full time grinder, but I mean, I took it as serious as you can take it when you're in that situation. Prior to the 2009 World Series, though, I don't know if you remember this, and maybe some of our viewers will, they used to do these bracelet races where you could buy in and you would get like a $2,000 package.
Mm-hmm.
And I was playing those. Well, what I was doing is I was satelliting in. I think they were like a 200 something dollar buy-in. But what I would do is I would usually satellite in, so it wouldn't cost me any more than like the $26.
Sure.
And I ended up, I cannot remember the exact number, but it was a sizable number of those packages. I think I won, I can't honestly remember, but it was about 10 or 11 of those packages, wow. Something like that.
Nice.
So then I knew, I was like, oh, mama's getting it now.
So did you end up playing a lot of WSOP events? You mentioned 2009. Have you been playing WSOP events since then?
The first WSOP event I played was 2008, and I won a seat into the ladies event.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say in 2008, I was definitely a beginner. I definitely, you know, wasn't like the bee's knees or anything,
sure.
But I thought I was okay. Because we all, you know, have those moments,
mm-hmm.
But I didn't do very well. I'm not going to lie to the viewers. I didn't.
It happens. So, but I mean, you've had tournament successes at, I want to say the River.
Yes, I final tabled the River main event, and I had satellited into that for $400, and I took pretty close to 100 G's from that.
Nice.
And in that same event, it's, you know, a couple weeks. I played the satellite to get my seat into the main event. And then I played one of the earlier, you know, small buy-in events. So I took 21st in the earlier event. So I won my satellite. I took 21st, and then I won almost 100 G's from the satellite. So that was a good series.
Nice.
And that was like 2013. Yeah, so.
Are satellites kind of your normal thing? Do you tend to do a lot of satellite runs before events? Like, do you do the same thing at the WSOP, or what's your thought and your plan there?
I'm frugal, so, you know, I like to, if I can get in for cheap, that's what I like to do. And, you know, I didn't come up really playing sit and goes. You know, I played some sit and goes, but I wasn't like, say, Jonathan Little, who was like the sit and go wizard or anything like that. But I feel like I have a good chance in sit and goes, and, you know, especially at the World Series. I mean, and our viewers, they all have a great chance too, because a lot of the players in those satellites, you know, are recreational players, and they don't really understand, you know, push fold and all that good stuff. So.
Right. Makes sense. Yeah, I don't blame you. So that kind of leads me to the next thing. So you're primarily a tournament player. So why did you go tournaments as opposed to cash games?
You know, I wish I had some like really great, well thought out answer for that. And I guess I don't. And in fact, the more I play tournaments, the more I know that I want to start adding cash to my repertoire.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like anybody who's primarily a tournament player, there's so many good reasons to add cash to your repertoire.
Sure.
But, you know, that's just kind of what I got into first. I think it's because, you know, we were playing in the basement and it was more like a tournament. And what was being televised on TV was tournaments.
Sure.
And so, and then I read Phil Hellmuth's books. I mean, book, 30 pages. Okay. But he's like the tournament king. So what else am I going to do, right?
Fair enough. That makes sense.
Although I did get the vacuum playing
you
cash.
You did get your vacuum playing cash. See, at least you have that story. Always have that vacuum and the story.
Right.
So you mentioned considering coming over to the dark side of cash games. So how's that process coming along?
You know, I feel like it's an interesting challenge for people who are tournament-based to go over to cash, because you definitely have to, you know, learn how to play deep stacks. But I think that's really important. Mm-hmm. And you have to really pick up your post-flop play, and that's really important. And when you live in the tournament world, you don't even, you know, you're not playing deep that much. You know, what if, depends on the structure, but, you know, a couple levels or whatever. Sure. And when you're not playing deep, you don't have to get as strong in the post-flop game.
Mm-hmm.
But what I find is really helpful is like the Red Chip site, because it is more geared towards cash. And I just feel like I've learned a lot from there. So I'm going to, you know, tear it up this summer playing some cash games. That's what I'm thinking.
And if you want to work on it, I'd be glad to sit down with you at a couple of cash game tables or have some fun.
Yeah, we'll totally have some fun. But I feel like, you know, anybody who is playing tournaments, the variance is so high. I mean, you can be a great tournament player and you can easily play 100 tournaments and not cash easily.
Sure.
And with your cash, I feel like you can even out your variance a little better.
Yep.
So I feel like for people who are playing tournaments primarily, it's a good idea to get into cash. So I'm definitely not one of those people that's like, I'm only going to play tournaments and I love tournaments and they're the best.
I mean, they're good. You get the home run potential with tournaments, but like you said, like the dry spells that you can run in tournaments is just, they're absurd. So definitely having some cash to lower that variance and enjoy making some money while you're, you know, God forbid, pitching on the circuit, definitely a good thing for the old bankroll.
Exactly.
100%. Good. So talked about that. So let's talk about some of the stuff you've created. You've created a tremendous amount of content. Let's start with your first book, which was Positive Poker. I believe you have a copy of that with you.
Let's
flash up so people
can
know what to... There it is. It's a beautiful book.
Yes.
Hold on. I'll even pop the link for you in the chat. So everyone that's watching, if you're interested, boom, there it is.
And people can also, just so they know, this is available in Kindle and it's available as an audio book. And if you can stand to listen, it's me reading every word of this book. So
how long did that take to record that?
A long time.
A long time.
Well, what you have to understand, I mean, I didn't know about this because I had never been in the studio before. I mean, I don't know the first thing about anything, you know, musical or studio wise, whatever.
Sure.
So I had no idea what it was like, but you go in and you put on the headset and the microphone is like this close to your face and
mm-hmm.
you read this book. And when you mess up, which you will do often, I mean, it seems like it'd be really easy to read the book, but it's not. So you mess up and you have to start over and, you know, all that. But I would say I went into the studio every day for like 4 hours a day for a couple weeks for sure.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I worked at
right.
people. But you
that
can.
You did.
I worked it. But if you're on audible.com and you've never like bought anything from there, you don't have an account or whatever, you can sign up and you can download a free book. And so you could download this one for free on Audible and listen to it.
Excellent. Good to know.
Yes.
So you co-wrote that with Jonathan Little.
Talk
a little bit about that process. So obviously Jonathan was interviewed here last week, if I'm not mistaken. So what's been your working relationship with Jonathan and how was the process of writing that book with him?
Well, I actually was a student of Jonathan's. So I took some classes with him and I took some private coaching with him. And I knew even before I took those classes or whatever that I wanted to put out this book. And it's in part based off of my dissertation. But I really wanted to bring, I don't know how to say it correctly, but I just wanted to bring scientific psychology to poker.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of what has been put out is not really based in, you know, research. It's just sort of somebody's opinion. And sometimes that does work. Sometimes what they have to say is good. But mm-hmm. I felt like, you know, there's just more to the story and I wanted to bring it out. And I felt like I wanted to work with somebody who was really psychologically balanced and who'd had a lot of success and who just is very reliable and consistent and all those things. Well, who else? I mean, Jonathan Little, right? He's
pretty much your best candidate. Yeah.
Yeah. And so it just so happened that I did some work with him, and I cannot say this is true for everybody. Can't guarantee any results, but my work with him, I worked with him for just a short amount of time, a few months. And when I say a few months, I mean like 3 or 4 or something like that. And then I took down $100,000 in tournament wins in that very short frame. So I'm just saying.
He is a great coach. He's good at what he does.
But so after that, I was like, hey, Jonathan, I want to work on this book. I want to do this book. And would you be interested? And so I sent him over the proposal, and he was really interested, because I didn't really know this, but back in the day when Jonathan was in college, he didn't stay in college very long because he was already making a ton of money playing poker, but he was a psychology major.
Okay.
He had a little bit of interest in psychology.
Excellent.
Yeah. So I thought that was really good. So yeah, I would write my chapter, and he would read it and give, you know, whatever his feedback was. But then he also wrote his sections on kind of how what I was saying relates to his game and how he's used those concepts and where he's, you know, made mistakes with those concepts and what he had to fix. And I feel like he's just such an open book too. So like if you read his part of the book, he's not shy about saying, you know, where he messed up or, you know, what he could have done better.
Sure.
I really like that about him.
Excellent. And did you guys write the book like 50-50? Was it a little bit more weighted one way or the other, or was it pretty close split?
No, it's definitely like, I would say more like 75% me, 25% him, because I'm putting down all of the psychology.
Sure. Okay. That makes sense.
And maybe even a little bit more, maybe even more like 80% me, 20% him, but I'm putting down all the psychology, and a lot of it he intuitively knew.
Sure.
And was using, but, you know, maybe he didn't know what it was called or why it worked, because a lot of what I cover in the book is the brain and how the brain operates and how you can optimize that for, you know, good results. And, you know, he wouldn't have any way of knowing that, but he like intuitively knew it.
Sure.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, 100% makes sense. So of your book, obviously it deals a lot with the mental side of the game. For someone that is, you know, who's it really written for? It's written for someone who's playing every single day and doing it professionally, for weekend warriors, for everyone. Who's kind of the target market for that book?
It's everyone. And I have to say to you, I mean, it's even if people don't play poker, they would find benefit in this book, because it's all about like focus and goal setting and discipline and how not to go crazy. You know, when bad things happen. And so really anybody could use it. It just happens to have poker examples and poker terminology and things, because that's what I'm into. And that's what Jonathan's into, but sure. You could take poker out and you could call this positive golf if you wanted to, or positive ping pong. It wouldn't matter, you know?
Fair enough. Good to
anybody
know.
Could benefit. Yeah.
I like it. So that was that book. Talk a little bit about your work on RedChip. So you've been making some very, very cool and different videos with David Paredes, aka Gaucho2121.
Yes.
Excellent. So what kind of topics have you guys been working on? And what are the videos like? Who are they for? Fill us in with the videos you've been making for RedChip.
All right. Well, I will tell you this. The way I even came to RedChip is your partner in crime, Doug Hull. He said to me, you have got to come to work for RedChip, because we want to feature Honey Badger on our channels, because I call myself the Honey Badger at the table a lot of the time, because I'm mean like a honey badger. So I was like, okay. And I think I made a couple things for you guys before I started with David, but then I have been doing with David, we've been doing coaching sessions for a few months now. He has an interesting story, because he's not going to be the type of guy that's going to tell you like, I'm a really great poker player, so I'm going to tell you he's a really great poker player. He really is. And unfortunately though, he's been on a downswing. Not anymore though, since working with me, and results cannot be guaranteed, but I'm just saying, He has turned it all around. But I feel like when you're on a downswing, you know, it hurts your confidence and it's like hard to get motivated to play. And you also maybe you do things that you wouldn't ordinarily do, like maybe you play more hands than you ordinarily would, or, you know, you take marginal spots more than you would, you know, just things like that.
Sure.
So we've done a number of videos with him, you know, where we've worked on his goal setting, and not just with poker, but he wants to do some other things. Like he wants to write a book. You know, he's really accomplished. He has a law degree. He also has a master's degree in creative writing. So, you know, he has like some other things that he wants to do.
Sure.
And so we talked a lot about that, and we've talked on there about confidence, discipline, you name it, like diet, because he wanted to lose some weight, which is diet and exercise. Even though people are like, well, poker is a very sedentary game. If you look at the best players, I'm thinking of like Jason Kuhn or even like Jonathan Little, they're really attuned to diet and exercise.
Sure.
So that's super important. So we've just worked on like the gamut of things with his game.
Excellent. So would you say, again, is this something that you feel would fit for everyone, or is this more for people that are, you know, pros, semi-pros, blah, 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 or yet another product that kind of like fits for everyone, one size fits all?
Well, sometimes I do get people coming to me and they want mental game coaching, like what I do with David. Mm-hmm. But the problem is they do not have the strategy. So sure. if your fundamental game is weak, all the mental game coaching in the world is not going to help you overcome that.
Right.
So people really need to have their fundamentals down. Having said that, you could work on your mental game alongside, you know, of the fundamentals. But if you're not working on your fundamentals and you're like, well, I can go see, you know, a mental game coach and it's going to make my game, you know, that's not going to happen.
True. Yeah. You definitely need both, just like someone that comes solely for strat but tilts off a buy-in and a half every single session is going to be just as screwed. So you definitely need both sides of your brain to be trained, to say the least.
I mean, a lot of people I think want the easy answer, but let's say I had never picked up a golf club before. Would I really go to a sports psychologist and say, make me a champion? I mean, I've never picked up a golf club before, but you can help me win the LPGA, right? If I spend my mind, right? I mean, we wouldn't do that. But in poker, we do that. I mean, you see that all the time where people hardly ever play, but they want to turn pro. Or sure. They, you know, they just, it's because I think you can get lucky and you can go to the Venetian and play the 1-2 when you don't know what you're doing and you can win $350 and get your vacuum.
Yep.
It tricks you into thinking. Although I feel like in my particular situation, you know, when I left the Venetian, I was happy I got my money from a vacuum, but I knew I wasn't the bee's knees for sure. You know,
right.
Like I knew I needed to go home and like really work. And I still feel that way. Even today, I need to work on my game and I have to continuously work on my game. So, you know, it is what it is in that regard. But
it is what it is. So 100%.
But I would say, like, if somebody has the fundamentals, they're working on them or they already have them down, then you definitely want to start looking at the mental game. I mean, just recently on a podcast, and we can talk about that more in a second, but
yeah.
I had somebody on, Daniel DeVores, and he's a coach over at Run It Once. And he said, in his opinion, the mental game at the lower levels, it's at least 30% mental game. And then as you go up in stakes, the proportion of mental game just becomes more and more important because everybody knows the strategy.
Exactly. 100% agree with that.
Yeah.
So 100%.
Mental game is, it's the final frontier. You know, there hasn't been a lot of good material put out on the mental game, even though some people might disagree with me and say, well, there is stuff out there. Yes, there is. But I feel like a lot of it is lacking. Well, a lot. I mean, that's relative because there's not much out there.
Sure.
But, you know, it's the final frontier. It's the last thing people are thinking about. And it was that way even in traditional sports too. You know, sports psychology started becoming popular like in the 80s. You know, I mean, a few people were dabbling it in the 70s and then it became bigger in the 80s and the 90s. It was more so. And now you would never see an Olympic athlete or a world champion that doesn't work with a sports psychologist.
Yeah, 100% agreed.
So I think poker is going to go the same way.
I agree. So, weird question. I'm just going to throw it out there off the top of my head. So, if someone were just getting started with poker, where would you suggest, would you suggest that they see a mental coach like after they've maybe studied for 100 to 200 hours? Would you suggest they do them both parallel? How would you suggest that they, because obviously there's both parts of the training when it comes to getting good at poker. How would you suggest like someone kind of new start in that respect?
I think, if you're new and you're just starting out, you could actually, like, if somebody came to me and they were brand new, I would help them figure out their study plan, and I would also help them figure out how to set good habits, because a lot of what happens is we get bad habits and they get entrenched with us, bad habits at the table.
Sure.
And then, you know what I mean? Like, it gets more and more ingrained. It's kind of like if I was trying to work on my golf swing in my house and I had a bad swing, but I didn't know it, and I kept doing it and doing it and doing it, then it's going to be hard to break me of that bad swing.
Right.
Does that make sense?
It totally makes sense.
Yeah. But I
100%.
mean, if you've never sat down and played, you're probably not going to have too much to go over.
Yeah.
But we could work on, like I said, your training plan. And maybe you have trouble in other parts of your life with your mental game. Maybe you're the type of person that gets frustrated, or maybe you have ADHD or something like that. A mental game coach can certainly help you with those sorts of issues, and that's going to help you with everything, but it can also help you with poker.
For sure. Yeah, that makes sense. So we talked a little bit about red chip stuff. And just kind of curious, what do you have in the pipeline for red chip videos? We mentioned earlier off camera talking a little bit about what you had coming up, but curious kind of what else you have in the pipeline, and can you share any video topics or anything that's coming up soon?
Well, I do have, this is going to come out in the April batch, if all goes well with the technology, and I think it will. But I'm going to have Zachary Elwood, and him and I are going to have an in-depth discussion about poker tells, which I know is something that many people are very interested in. So I think that's going to be good. And
Excellent.
I have ideas for a lot of things, and some of what I'd like to do, though, is tailor to what the red chip community wants. So if they do, put out there what they want. Obviously, everybody's like tilt, 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 and that is important, but there are so many other things too. So if people do have interest, let us know, and I can certainly shape and mold, my content to fit what they want.
Excellent. Yeah. And if you guys have suggestions or anything like that, you can drop them in the forum. You can drop them on Twitter. And your Twitter is at Dr. Tricia Cardner, Dr. Tricia Cardner. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Excellent. I actually remember that off the top of my head. I'm kind of impressed with myself right now.
I'm super impressed, although maybe that just means you're tweeting me too much.
Yeah, but it does autofill for me. So it's definitely not, I shouldn't be remembering that, but for whatever reason, it's stuck in there.
Like that. I like that.
I try, right? All right, so let's get into some of the new stuff that you're coming out with as well. So one of the big projects that you're involved in, along with a million other authors, it seems like, except for myself, is Excelling at No Limit Hold'em, the new book with Jonathan Little and a million other people. So why don't you talk about what your well, what the book is about, what the chapter is about? Fill us in a little bit on what's going on with this book.
Well, okay, here was the idea. Jonathan thought that, he gets an opportunity. He travels and he goes to the WPTs and the EPTs and whatever, right? And he has a ton of friends, and whenever he would talk to his friends, they would all be talking about, different areas of poker. And he just got the idea that, hey, wouldn't it be great if everybody could hear this stuff, because this is like good stuff. So he decided that he would put together a book, and it's the Excelling at No Limit Hold'em, and it's got a ton of really great authors on it. I mean, I don't know if you want me to say who some of them are, but I
Sure.
certainly can.
By all means, for sure.
I mean, I feel like who I'm excited about, Olivier Bousquet is one of the authors, and that, is great. Assassinato, what's his name? Alexander Fitzgerald, I think.
Fitzgerald, yep.
Yep. Will Tipton is on there, and I'm super excited to see what he has to say.
Awesome.
Yeah, I
Ed
mean,
Miller,
it's
Ed Miller's
Ed
on
Miller.
that.
Yeah, how could I forget Ed Miller? I mean, Ed Miller is one of the greatest poker authors of all time. he's on there. Bernard Lee, Mike Sexton. I hope I didn't mention him twice, but you know, I really love Mike Sexton. So he's on there.
And yeah. And your favorite, you read his book.
Phil Hellmuth, people.
Mr. Phil Hellmuth. Mr. Phil.
Phil Hellmuth, okay. Yeah, Liv Boree is a contributor. Zachary Elwood, who we mentioned before, he's the Poker Tells guy. And I got to say, honestly, I feel like his material on Poker Tells is the best out there. And kind of like the mental game, there hasn't been that much done on it, surprisingly. But his stuff is real good.
Which is kind of weird that there hasn't been a lot done on that.
I know, it really is, right?
Yeah.
And there's a reason why there hasn't been a lot done on it, and we're actually going to cover it in our video for Red Chip, so.
Awesome. Excellent.
Sneak peek. But anyway, this book is, I feel like, it's the biggest thing to come out since Super System in terms of just the breadth, because it doesn't matter if you're a recreational player, there's something for you. If you're a pro, it's there for you. Whether you're live, you're online, no matter what your game, there's going to be something for you in that book. Chris Moneymaker is even in it.
Is he really?
Yes.
I did not know that. That's awesome. Yeah. Well, there is another mental coach in there as well, right? Elliot's in there.
Elliot Rowe is in there. Jared Tendler has a chapter in there. So,
oh my God, so I feel all of you are in there.
I feel like the mental game is well represented. Like I said, tournaments, online, cash, you name it, beautiful. We got it.
Yeah. So the obviously there's three essentially mental coaches, you, Elliot, and Tendler. So did you guys all write together? Did you write chapters individually? Do you know what both of them are covering? Like, what does that all look like?
Well, we didn't write them together. We each have our own chapter. Mine is mental toughness, which I think is really important. Elliot's is on hypnosis, obviously, because he does hypnotherapy and he's the best hypnotherapist that I know personally. Mm-hmm. And I'm certified in hypnotherapy, just so you know. So I've seen some hypnotherapists in my day. And then Tendler's is a kind of a synopsis of Tilt, you know, kind of the work that he's done in his previous books. Mm-hmm. And as far as I know, Zachary is also kind of I would say synopsis of his work, but also I know Zachary because I've just recently talked to him. He's brought new things into that chapter as well.
Oh, awesome. Very good. So you said mental toughness. Can you give us a little sneak peek what that looks like? What kind of, or any tips you can give people in that realm?
Yeah. And, you know, mental toughness is really a tough nut to crack because you always hear people talk about you need to be mentally tough. But then it's like, well, what does that even mean? Mm-hmm. So in the chapter, I talk a lot about, you know, resilience, being able to bounce back, you know, and how you can specifically do that and things you can do to just build up your mental toughness. There's an Eastern concept and basically you need to learn to eat bitterness. That's what it translates to. In the Eastern cultures, like in our culture, it's all win, 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 right? Mm-hmm. And if you're not winning, you know, it's bad. You want to win immediately. Whereas right. In the Eastern cultures, it's more like go through the process and learn how to take your lumps. That's just kind of built into their philosophy and culture and their way of life. Mm-hmm. So there's some of that, you know, people just really need to realize, especially with something as complicated as poker, that you're going to get kicked in the teeth a lot of the time, even if you're one of the best players in the world.
Right. Yeah. And especially with a game like poker where there is so much luck involved. I mean, you can play really, really well and still get screwed in the face a ton and you still have to be able to deal with those lumps. So definitely love the fact you're talking about that in a chapter. How long was the chapter?
You know, it's been a while since I wrote it, but it seems like it just got longer and longer because Jonathan was like, tell me more. And I would go back to my keyboard and put some more, but it's definitely no fluff because I'm not a fluffy type of person. I don't feel like in my writing and whatever, I'm just very to the point, mm-hmm. You know, so I don't like to put in a lot of filler. So there's definitely no filler in it. Gosh, I think it was probably like somewhere between 15 and 20,000 words, my chapter. So
seriously?
I mean, wow. I had a lot to say.
That you did. That's going to be a monstrous book then.
It's over 500 pages long. I do know that.
Whoa.
I'm telling you, people, you're going to get your money's worth on this book. Even if you said, I'm only interested in half the chapters, even if you were only interested in a fourth of the chapters, you're going to get your money's worth.
That's awesomely good. Any idea what the price tag is? It is. Hold on one sec. I actually have the link for this.
I think the list on it is $39.95 maybe, but you know how Amazon is. It never sells at that price.
Oh my God. That's incredibly sick value.
Yeah. I think you can pre-order right now. And I think it's in the 20 something dollar range maybe.
Yeah. It's only 30 bucks.
Yeah. So I do know for people who are going to be out at the World Series, okay, you can pre-order the book right now on Amazon, but the book will be available. I believe, don't quote me on this, but the date is June the 11th or the 13th. And I feel like it's the 13th, but I can't remember for sure. But anyway, we are hopefully going to have a launch party out in Vegas because all of us are going to be there for the World Series. And so we'll be there to meet and greet and sign your books and maybe give you a few tips or whatever.
That's excellent. Awesome. Awesome. A lot to look forward to in June then.
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%. Well, are you going to be out there for the entire series?
Oh, yeah.
Is that what you do every year?
That's what I do every year since 2009. Wow. Haven't missed a year. Don't want to miss a year. I love it. And this year, the series has got some really interesting things in it, events. So, like, the Colossus is pretty interesting to me. Of course, the Millionaire Maker, the Monster Stack. I mean, anything that has, like, a specialty name, I'm just digging.
For sure. What's your schedule usually look like? Do you play everything? Do you play everything under five? Like, what's your typical schedule look like there?
I mean, I spread the love around. I don't just play at the series. So I like to play over at the Wynn when they do the Wynn Classic, and they have games. Oh, well, they have tournaments that are like, I'd say in the 350 to 550, 600 range, something like that. So I feel like those are really good value. I took third place in one of those last year or year before. I can't remember when, but anyway. Nice. So I like those. Last year I played over at Planet Hollywood. It was the first time they had that series. They kind of took it over, I feel like, from Caesars. Loved it. The crowds were insane. The fields were like, I mean, the buy-ins were really low. They were a couple hundred dollars, if I remember right. But the fields were like 1,000 people, 1,300 people, and they were terrible. No offense to anybody who's watching who might have played there, because you were probably great. But the people on my tables tended to be terrible. And by terrible, I mean like weak, you know, like they were just tourists, a lot of them. And sure. They were like, oh my God, this tournament's going on at Planet Hollywood. And it's, you know, a couple hundred bucks. And they were playing. And yeah, it was great.
Well, Planet Hollywood room is like seven tables. Where do they host it?
They hosted it upstairs, and it was right outside of where Britney Spears does her show.
Gotcha.
There's like a theater, but actually it was quite nice. I didn't mind it at all. So you go up the escalator, and it's just like this whole big wide open area. And there was tables, not as many as the World Series, but a lot of poker tables. And behind it is sort of like the convention type area. So the restrooms were there. And just because it was up on the top, it wasn't like smoky and stuff.
Awesome.
Really. I mean, you know, any casino is going to have some smoke, but it wasn't too bad. If they're running that again, people should definitely check that out. I always hit Binion's during the Poker Classic for one or two things, just because I love Binion's, in case I hadn't screamed that out enough. I love the dealers there. They've all been dealing since longer than I've been alive. They know what they're doing. The floor people are nice to me. I love it over there. Yeah.
I'd imagine as a female, isn't everyone nice to you in this industry? I can't imagine that females get treated too badly in this industry.
Well,
not the case, I see.
I've never been treated poorly by anybody who works in the poker industry, you know, like the dealers or floor people, nothing like that. They're always quite nice, but by other players, that's a different story.
Yeah, so we're going to have to crack that egg open. So as a male, obviously, I have no idea about this. I'm also a gentleman, so I never treat a woman differently. What are your experiences in poker as a female?
I mean, I would say I very rarely have a bad experience. So let me just put that out there. What I'm going to say, it very rarely happens. Okay. Mm-hmm. You know, when I go out in the summer, I play every day for 30, 40 days straight, however long I'm there. And so out of all of that, you know, I might have one or two things. So it's not like it's every day or anything like that.
Sure.
But I think I can hold my own in terms of, like, if you're going to get smart alecky with me, I can certainly snap back.
Is that what it is? They just kind of talk to you differently? Mm-hmm. Are they, like, legitimately disrespecting you? Or, like, I have, like, no idea.
I have had the experience with one guy where he literally threw his chips at me. And I don't think he would have done that if I was a man. Really? They're definitely dudes that if they lose a hand to a woman, and especially if it's, you know, they're all in and you beat them and they have to leave, that's usually when it happens. It's not just sure. A single hand. But yeah, I've had the chips thrown at me before. I had a guy, he was like cussing at me, but like I said, I'm going to bite back. So, you know, I let him know what was what. I mean, so you do see some of that. You know, you'll see some, they're true. Some guys will soft play you, but some women will soft play you too, if you know how to talk to them right. So
really,
that's a plus.
There you go. Yeah. Free money for you.
But in general, I don't find that men soft play. As a general, I don't find that they do. As a general rule, I find that they probably play with you a little bit more just because they think it's easier to, you know, to get one over on you. You know,
would you say that's the most common thing, that they're trying to run bluffs on you that they probably couldn't get away otherwise, thinking you're going to be weak tight? Or what's the normal?
I do believe the normal adjustment. Yeah, I do believe the perception is that women are weak tight. But on the other hand, and I'm not talking amongst the best players, because I think the best players are aware that anybody could, you know, get you, or anybody could know what they're doing. But I feel like it's the lesser players, so maybe the intermediates on down, that tend to do this. Mm-hmm. They have a stereotyped idea that, you know, they can bully you. That's, you know, you'll see that a lot. You know, whatever. Bring it, boys. I got a lot of friends in the UFC, so bring it.
And that's actually an absolutely perfect segue to the new project with Elliot Rowe. So that's your podcast. And why don't you fill us in? What's it called? What's it all about? I know your first episode got launched, I think, 4 or 5 days ago. Talk to us about...
It was like Friday night, which was not a good time to launch. But, well, you know, we buck the trends. What can we do?
I like it.
Yeah, Elliot Rowe and I were doing the Mindset Advantage podcast, which is on iTunes, available for download. So people can go over there, and it's myself and Elliot Rowe. And we are interviewing a wide range of just really accomplished people, a lot of poker players, because we know a lot of poker players, but also a lot of people out of the UFC, MMA, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. We just had on Robert Drysdale, who's a 6-time Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu world champion, who also fights with the UFC. But the tone of it is all about mental game and why the mental game is important, and how they use it, and, you know, how you can improve it, and just things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So the first episode, which is released, you know, right now, that people can get, is Dan DeVoris, who's over at Run It Once, which I mentioned him earlier. Outstanding advice he gave, I thought, and it was something, you know, he's a phenomenal player. He's a high stakes cash player, for people who don't know him. And just, I mean, he is so into the mental game, and he gave away his whole like pre-competition routine. So people can listen to that and they can hear what he does to prepare for, you know, tournaments. And I've never heard him talk about these things before. You know, he doesn't really give a ton of interviews, and, mm-hmm. but he came on with us and he revealed all. And so I think people would find that very interesting.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Was he difficult to crack open, or was he pretty much, once you gave him a topic, he went with it?
No, he totally went with it. We've already recorded 5 episodes, and everybody who's been on has been like phenomenal about, you know, just laying it all out there. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, we're not really interviewing anybody who, you know, wants to keep it on the down low, right? Because if they come on the show, they gotta tell all, because inquiring minds want to know.
Exactly. Right? Wouldn't work if they didn't.
Yeah.
So what parallels are you finding between the poker players and the UFC guys? Because you said you've done a little bit of both, because you've recorded a few of these. What kind of parallels are you seeing between the two?
I tell you, it's so closely aligned. It's amazing, you know, because when you're going to go in the ring, you have to be focused. You have to anticipate, you know, what your opponent's going to do, because you don't know exactly what they're going to do.
Sure.
And it's so much like that in poker too, right? And if you go in the ring, you have to be constantly adjusting, you know, and if they put their hand here, you know, where are you going to put your hand? You know, and it's just so much like the same as in poker. It's like I said, psychology is psychology is psychology, right?
Right.
But I feel like it's so interesting, you know, for example, with Robert Drysdale, you know, just getting a black belt in jiu-jitsu, it's the hardest black belt to get. And it takes really a minimum of 10 years, if not more like 12 or 14.
Wow.
So you are talking a tremendous amount of dedication. I mean, and he trains twice a day and, you know, he gets hypnotized all the time, you know, to just give himself that extra edge. And, you know, any idea that I might have had, a preconceived idea about, you know, what a UFC fighter or an MMA guy would be like, because, you know, I've seen it all on TV, but that's different than like actually, you know, having a conversation.
Sure.
It's, you know, they're so well-spoken, so mentally tough. Just, I mean, you could learn a lot of really neat things from everybody that we're talking to, the poker players too. I mean, every poker player we've had on, same thing. So well-spoken, so intelligent, just, you know, wanting to be the best, doing whatever it takes to be the best. And I just have a high level of admiration for anyone who's willing to put that kind of time and effort in, no matter, you know, what their craft is. Mm-hmm. So I'm loving it. I'm loving it. I hope we podcast forever, because I'm loving it.
Fingers crossed. And are you guys going to be releasing every Friday? Is it going to be random?
We haven't ironed out the release schedule completely, because, you know, we're just getting new to this, and neither one of us is like knows the first thing about podcasting, to be honest with you. So we're ironing out, but we definitely don't want to be releasing on a Friday. It just worked out that way this time. I'm expecting the second episode to go up, you know, maybe tomorrow, I'm not totally sure, but our plan is to get to where we have a specific release day, and we are going to be releasing every week.
Excellent. And are you guys on iTunes? Is that where people can download it?
Yeah, we are on iTunes. So people can go over there, and it's also on Elliot's website, and my website's under construction, but it will be on mine, drtrishacardner.com, very soon. So yeah, they can get it. And if you go on iTunes, you can like it, you can subscribe, you can rate it, comment. I don't know. You can do all kinds of things.
All that kind of good stuff. And one more time, it's called The Mindset Advantage.
It's The Mindset Advantage Podcast, just in case anybody was confused.
Excellent. So only one more question for me before we open it up to Q&A. And we've talked about you being a tournament player. We've talked about you being a mental coach. So what tips can you give for someone who's going to play their first WSOP this year?
Oh gosh, that's a big one. I would say the thing that I feel like most people are not aware of when it comes to the World Series, if you've never been, is the stamina that it takes. Because you're going to get there and you're going to get there a little early, right? But you're going to start playing at noon, and you're probably going to play, let's hope you play well and you don't bust or whatever. So you're going to be playing until like 2 a.m. So you need to start thinking about that right now. And, you know, I'd say add some exercise to your routine. I would also say start meditating at least a few minutes a day, every day, because when you get there, it's going to be crazy. Okay, there's a lot of stimulation.
Sure.
Crazy. And so you already want to have the habits of, you know, meditating for a few minutes every day. If you don't know how to meditate, you know, I've got some short meditations in Positive Poker. And I know you've written some articles on meditation, James.
Mm-hmm. So you can over on Redchip, yep.
people to that. A few minutes every day, you want to start doing that. I'd say start working on your diet too. You want to be eating good, healthy foods. You just want to like prime your engine, if you will.
For sure.
Get yourself a place to stay, whether it's, you know, a hotel or if you're renting a house or whatever. But I think you need to do that. Okay. If you haven't done it, because time is a wasting, you know, don't procrastinate on that kind of thing, because then there's just nothing worse than not having a comfortable place to stay. Okay.
Right.
You know, take comfortable clothes. It is butt freezing cold in the World Series almost always.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say butt freezing cold, like a couple of years ago, one of the guys on my table, I have no idea why he had this, but he literally had a thermometer and it was 61 degrees.
Was it really?
Yes.
Wow.
So, but I'll see guys that come and I'm sure they've never been to the series before. And they're just like, you know what? I'm in town and it'd be fun to play like $1,000 event. And they come in and they're wearing shorts, a t-shirt and like flip flops. It's miserable. So don't do that. Gosh, what else do you want to know? Like, because I've been doing this for a few years, so I feel like I could give you some good intel. Like, what do you think people want to know specifically?
All right, so I'm going to ask a couple things that, if nothing else, interest me, and I'm sure other people will understand. So if you've never gone to the series before, like Tricia said, it's bonkers nuts. And yes. If you start working on a schedule now, you can start adhering to it, get your discipline with it, get used to it, so that when the series comes, you're prepared and you don't just get totally swamped off, because it's really easy to do that. Yes. So you mentioned playing from noon until about 2 a.m., and then obviously you're right back on the tables at noon. So how can someone like work with a sleep schedule like that? Because it's really kind of a late time to go to sleep and your sleep schedule is going to get really zonked. So how can people work through that and kind of practice for it, so to speak?
Yeah, that is a challenge, because I'll tell you what, I bag up frequently. So I play really late, and some of the tournaments. So just so people are aware, okay, when I'm talking about bagging up at 2, that would be like the bracelet events. If you play the daily deep stacks, you will not bag up. You will play all night long. And I final tabled those before. And so you start, they've changed the time a little bit, but you used to start, I think it was 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And I literally have finished playing at like 7, 8, 9 o'clock the next morning. So you don't get a break on those. There's no dinner break on the daily deep stack. There's nothing like that. It's you're playing through. Okay.
Brutal.
And if you play the 6 p.m. because they have a 6 p.m. daily also, and they have a 10 p.m. daily. And I have played those and final tabled those as well. Same thing. You will play all night long and it will be until you finish. Mm-hmm. So just be aware that on a lot of these tournaments, you're not going to even get a dinner break. You're not going to bag up. You're going to be playing through.
Yep.
Yeah. And so, but it can be a challenge if you play the bracelet events and you bag up and then you get home. And like, for me, I'm always like awake. I'm like, I got to eat. I got to think about what I did, you know, just all kind of stuff.
Reload for the next day. So how can they get themselves to a point where they can fall asleep before 6 o'clock in the morning?
I think that's where the meditation comes in, you know, like if you're a practiced meditator, well, then you can meditate, you know, and to decompress. And then that's really going to help you go to sleep, I think.
For sure.
And really get things like you like it, you know, make sure your room is comfortable. You know, it can't be too hot, can't be too cold, it can't be light. You know, whatever you need, earplugs, white noise machine, whatever you need, bring it, get it, whatever. And it may sound like I'm being high maintenance here, but you want to be as in good a form as you can be to play those long hours.
Mm-hmm.
So,
And whether you're going to be there for a week or be there for a month, it's best to stay in one place the whole time, in my opinion. You don't want to have to be room moving every week. And
absolutely
it's
not
good, because like you said, you want to have your own space where you're comfortable, have a place where you're set up, have temp where you're comfortable, lighting, whatever. So if you can stay in the same place, whether it's a week, whether it's a month, definitely make sure you keep that in mind, just to kind of add on to your make it comfortable thing.
Yeah, for me, I do not stay at the Rio. I did the first time I came out, but I only came out for one event. So I think if you're only coming out for like the one event, or, you know, maybe like a weekend or so, it's fine. You know, stay at the Rio.
Sure.
If you do stay at the Rio, I recommend the Ipanema Tower because it's the closest to where you play the World Series. So there you go.
That makes sense.
Yeah. But if you're staying longer than that, I would say anywhere but the Rio almost is the way I feel. I just, you know, to me, I want to get away from it. I don't want to deal with it, but I stay for a really long time. I'm usually there, you know, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, something like that. So I rent a place, you know, either a house or a townhouse or something like that. So that way I have a full kitchen, I have washer and dryer, you know, all that kind of thing. So if people are going to stay for a while, that's what I recommend doing.
100%. So you mentioned sometimes you don't even get dinner break, and it's just kind of important to talk about food anyway. So what would you suggest people do in terms of diet? Because okay. Like you said, you could be playing for large chunks of time and eating is important.
Okay. I'm a big baby myself. So I have to have my food because if I don't, my blood sugar gets low and I could get crazy and I don't want to have that. So I pack food and I suggest packing nuts because they're high protein and they're high in the good types of fats. I always have banana. A lot of times will bring like an apple. Sometimes I'll even bring sandwich because I have those little cold packs. I mean, I feel like a pack mule when I go because I bring all my food. I bring plenty of water. I mean, and I know you can get it there, but sometimes when you're sitting, especially at the World Series, you can ask the waitress for water and you might not see it for 30 minutes or more. And sure. I don't like that. So I have my own stuff. I always bring a jacket, which sounds crazy because it's 120 degrees, but I'm telling you, it can be 60 degrees in there and it's no joke. And you see big grown men and they're, you know, shivering. And how can you think clearly when, you know, you're cold. So right. I'd say bring a backpack. If you like to listen to music while you play, you know, make sure you have music. I like doing that myself. Some people don't, some people do. So whatever works for you, bring backup batteries for, you know, your phone and, you know, your iPod or whatever thing you have. It's just, for me, it's about being comfortable and I don't care if I have to come like a pack mule. You know, but bring a backpack or a tote. I know, James, you're probably making fun of me right now. You're thinking.
Not at all. I have my poker tote right over there. Well, I guess not a tote, but a small backpack that I always bring everywhere. It has my backup charger and nuts and all that stuff in it as well. So I totally hear what you're saying.
Yeah. I mean, I think that is one way you can tell who's the experienced player is versus the non-experienced players, because you always see the experienced players. They have like a duffel bag or a backpack or a tote. They've got something. And then you see these other random guys that have like their t-shirt and shorts and flip-flops on, and you know, that's not a serious player.
No, that's their first time there. And they are going to have a miserable four hours until they bust out.
Exactly. And I'm not doing that. I mean, I might bust out in 40 minutes, but I'm going to be comfortable doing it.
Exactly. So what is the weird question? I'm actually curious if you know it. What is the shortest amount of time it's taken you to bust from a WSOP event?
I don't know. That is a good question. I've never busted like super fast.
No.
Outside of the very first women's event that I played, that one I probably busted in like level two or something ridiculous. But outside of that, I tend to be pretty good about running deep. You know, if I get any amount of chips, I can day two. That's the thing.
Fair enough.
I mean, anything could happen, right? I mean, I've never just like busted on the first hand. You just have to know I don't get good cards. So I never have the opportunity to bust in the first hand. So there you have it.
Well, there's always the opportunity to bust in the first hand. It's just how hard you want to push it.
Yeah, I don't push it that hard. You know, what was really shocking to me, last year was the first year that they had the monster stack. And you got 15,000 in chips for the 1,500 buy-in. And the blind started at 25-25. So that's massively deep. And to me, you have to really be working to bust out of that. I can't even tell you how many people busted in like the first level of that. It was insane.
Seriously?
It was an insane zoo. Yes, seriously. I've never seen that many people bust a turn. I thought nobody's going to bust this, right? It's going to be like 4 hours before anybody busts this. No, people were going to that exit like nobody's business. I couldn't even believe it. Yeah. Don't Jesus. Do that, people. No. When you're deep, do not give it away. I mean, I can understand a cooler, you know, like if you've got quads and they've got the royal flush, okay, fine. But don't give it away, you right. know, like, and I think a lot of people are thinking, oh, well, if I double up quick, fast in the hurry, then I'm going to have 30,000 chips. But functionally, the difference between 30,000 and 15,000 is nothing at 25, 25 blinds. It doesn't even make a difference.
Doesn't matter until day two.
Just the thing is, get to day two and, you know, get to day two with a reasonable stack, if at all possible. Right. But it doesn't have to be the biggest stack. You know, if you go to day two with an average stack, you don't need to be worried about it. It's fine.
Yeah. I mean, average stack on day two is still what, 60 or 70 big blinds most of the
exactly.
time?
Exactly. I mean, yeah. most of the time. And even if it was only 30 or 40, you still got time. Yeah. So calm down, people.
Plenty of time. Exactly. Ship it. All right. So I think I'm good on my side. We're going to open up the floor and let people fire through. I've seen it out of the corner of my eye. There's been a lot of chit chatting over the corner. So I'm just going to fire questions at you. You ready for that?
Okay. I'm ready for rapid fire. I hope I have some All good right. answers.
I'm sure you will. Won't be a problem. All right. All right, so I can't read that because I'm colorblind. Players VG2K says, why or what did you find out doing your qualitative or quantitative analysis of what poker players said?
Well, you'd have to read my dissertation to get the full Monty, and that might actually be the cure for not being able to sleep when you have those late nights James was talking about. But I basically found that if you want to be a winning player, a champion, you're going to have to do a lot of things that you might not want to do. So, like as an example, if you want to become a really great poker player, you're going to have to put in a lot of work. Mm-hmm. And it's like the 10,000 hour rule. You know, that was popularized by Malcolm Gladwell in his book Outliers. He basically said, if you want to be an expert at something, you need to have 10,000 hours experience. And everybody's like, oh, 10,000 hours. Well, that's not exactly right. It's 10,000 hours of deliberate practice, which is actually very different than just 10,000 hours of playing poker. Well, when I studied, that was one of the things that I did ask questions about. And guess what? If you want to become a true champion, I'm not talking about, and I don't mean any disrespect, but I'm not talking about like a Jamie Gold situation where he ran like Jesus and he won the main event a few years ago. But I don't think, you know, we would consider him a player who's like a great strategist or a master thinker in the game or anything like that.
Sure.
If you look at someone like Greg Merson, who I believe is a master strategist and just very, you know, like when it comes to poker, that guy is like a genius. Mm-hmm. I assure you, he has way more than 10,000 hours deliberate practice, a lot more. And that is what I found to be true for the people that I interviewed for my dissertation. So you also have to have the requisite things like confidence. And not ego, but confidence. So that was real important. Bankroll management was one of the number one things that the players I interviewed talked about. And that surprises players who are, you know, maybe at just starting out or whatever. You got to realize in poker, you only have two things. You have your bankroll, your capital, and you have your brain. And that's pretty much what you're working with. So you have to preserve your brain and you have to preserve your bankroll. If you go broke, you're not in the game. If you're, you know, not treating your brain well, it's not going to work out. So those were some of the things that I found that I think people could, you know, think about and apply in their game, like right now. Mm-hmm. Having discipline, super important. Patience, you know, emotional control. I mean, that's really what tilt boils down to, is not having emotional control. You know, I mean, if you look at, I'll tell you one of the best beats, and he probably didn't think it was the best beat, but there, it was a few years ago, and Sean Deeb, I believe he was in the small blind. He had pocket aces, and it was like somebody had raised before him. And it seems like somebody raised, and maybe somebody called, and he raised with the aces. And I think the guy's name is Henselman, was in the big blind, although I could be butchering his name, and I might not even be remembering this right, but that's what I remember. He had an ace six offsuit. I know for a fact he had ace six offsuit. Well, he re-raises. Okay, well, the first couple guys, they fold. Well, Sean Deeb is like, hallelujah. You know, if I raise this guy again, you know, I can probably get him to punt off. You know, because the guy's not sitting there thinking Sean Deeb has got aces, right?
Sure.
He's thinking Sean Deeb is making a move. Well, so Sean Deeb, you know, back raises again. And, you know, he kind of makes it an amount where Henselman or Heinzman, I can't remember exactly what his name was. But anyway, he made an amount that he can induce the shove. The guy shoves with his ace six. Of course, Sean's like, I call, and he's happy as a clam. Well, the flop comes with a six, and then I think it was the river was the other six. And it crippled Sean Deeb. Had he won that hand, I have no doubt that he would have made a huge run. This was in the main event. I have no doubt of it. But instead, he was busted down to like 9 or 10 big blinds, and he's about to go, and that's going to be the end of it. But you didn't even see him flinch, Sean Deeb. If you watch that, you went, you know, I mean, I don't know, maybe when he got off the table, he kicked a dog or something, but I don't think he did. I think he just has that, you know, mental control where he's just like, it is what it is. Like, I want the guy to punt off with ace six offsuit all day, every day. And when the guy did what he wanted, but of course, Sean didn't get the results he wanted, but he's not going to throw a fit about that. You know what I'm saying?
Right. 100%.
So that's another thing that players need to think about is emotional control. And when I get what I want, I can't really get mad about it.
So true. All right. So the next one's actually semi-related to that. Hello. What is the best way to keep concentration for 3 or more hours and not let tilt affect you?
Oof. Yeah, that's tough because concentration and focus takes a lot of mental energy. So I've got a few ideas on this. First of all, make sure that you're eating properly and you're hydrating properly, because if you're hungry or you're thirsty, you're not going to be able to focus. You know, take little mental breaks. You know, you're supposed to be watching all the action and paying attention to everything that's going on, but you can, you know, while the dealer's changing decks, for example, just zone out and do a little mini meditation. That's going to help you to concentrate. Okay. Mm-hmm. You know, if something just really tilts you, get up from the table. You know, you can get up from the table for a few minutes. You don't have to stay there. And if you miss a hand or two, that's fine. I have players that work with me. I have them record hands. I also have them record, you know, feelings. I know people hate that, especially dudes are like, feelings, right? It's so lame. But what I mean by that is, like, say you were in the hand with the aces and the guy sucks out on you with the ace six, right? Well, what'll happen is some thoughts pop into your head, and they come into your head really quickly. And then they light up that amygdala, which is the part of your brain that's like the alarm system. And then you overreact and you throw a monitor, the chair, or whatever you do, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, well, instead of doing that, if you would instead notice what thought popped into your head, write it down, and then just be like, is that thought even logical? Like, usually it's not. Usually those thoughts, they have to do with we're upset because we felt entitled to win the hand, and nothing is certain in life but taxes and death, I promise you that. So you're never entitled to anything. But that's what our, you know, that's what comes into the head. Or it has to do with, I'm not going to let them bully me, especially I find that around 3-betting. If somebody 3-bets you a lot of people get that idea like, I'm not going to let them bully me, I'm going to show them. And then about the time you decide to show them, that's the time they actually have the hand.
Yep.
Yeah. So I hope that was somewhat helpful.
I think so. So, oh, this is fantastic. Other than SplitSuit, who do you think is the hottest poker player?
Oh, man. Y'all are really putting me on the spot here. Okay, well, I would give a couple of answers to that. I mean, it goes without saying SplitSuit is number one. This is probably Christian Soto asking this question, hoping I'll say Christian Soto. But one of my friends, this was a few years ago, she was really in love with Gus Hansen. And I was at the World Series and I saw Gus Hansen, and I never really thought too much about, like, he's not really my type, but, but I have to say, I went up to him to tell him, you know, how much my friend loved him and to get a picture of him so I could give it to her. And he really exudes a lot of charisma, I have to say. It's like Gus Hansen, the prettiest boy in poker with, I mean, has to be Patrick Antonius. I mean, I haven't seen him lately. But, you know, I used to, when I would win all those bracelet races with Full Tilt, I would get to go into the Full Tilt suite. So they would have like food and drink, and all the big, you know, Full Tilt people would be there as well. And when he was in there, it was a good day in the neighborhood, I have to say.
Excellent. All right. So Bancoin says, almost without fail, I start making mistakes after 3 or 4 hours. Not sure if it's ADD or what. Any tips on how to prolong my A game, or should I just avoid long sessions?
Well, I think if you know it goes badly for you, you know, cut the sessions off. That's a real good idea. You know, not everybody can play for 8 hours optimally, nor should they. So that's a fine idea. If he knows that he has or she has ADHD, you know, you might want to look at visiting your physician if you take medication, and maybe do a little bit of tweaking with that. Meditation is excellent for developing the prefrontal cortex, which helps us with concentration, meditation, and focus. So start meditating for sure. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're in a tournament, it's like you can't get up. You know what I mean? Well, you right. can, but... You probably don't want to. And if you're in a cash game, I feel like you should set your time parameters for what is optimal for you. So sure. If you know 3 to 4 hours, then do what's optimal for you. If you're in a tournament situation, you know, build your stamina as much as you can. And one of the ways you can do this, and people are going to say, this sounds so boring, but going into the series, before the series, like I'd say right now, start watching poker videos. And as you get really close to the series, start watching poker videos for 8 or 10 hours a day and see how much you can concentrate. And, you know, you can build up. The more you concentrate and focus, it's like a muscle. You know what I mean? So the more sure. you use it, the more you can do it. Mm-hmm. So
I think that's a great piece of advice.
A lot of people will say, I don't want to watch training videos for 8 or 10 hours a day. That's so boring. But, you know, sitting at a tournament for 8 or 10 hours it has its own boredom too, for sure.
100%. Nap and Crash says, is it common for confidence to plummet during a downswing, even after a large successful sample size?
And no, I don't think it is uncommon. I think it's very common when you feel like you're doing everything right and you're getting kicked in the head, you know, even if you had been successful for years and then you go into that downswing and it lasts a while. I mean, even look at David Paredes. I mean, like I say, he's a great player, and I don't feel like he's going to come out and say he's a great player. I'm going to have to say it for him because he's like a humble guy, but he mm-hmm. really is a great player, and he's had years of being a great player. And then all of a sudden, you know, he goes on a downswing of like 12 or 13 sessions. And it's enough to just, you know, really be disheartening. And then I think you start wondering, like, well, what am I doing wrong? And you might not right. be doing anything wrong, but you're wondering that, right? What am I doing wrong? Or my favorite, like, why are the poker gods against me? I think that's very natural to do that.
100% agreed.
Yeah, I mean, you probably see that a lot with, because I know you coach, and you probably see that with your students.
Yeah, and I mean, the toughest thing about being a poker player is when things are going poorly, really trying to stay objective and saying, is it me? Am I making mistakes, either my strategy or my mental, or am I playing too long of sessions, or am I tilt spewing somewhere, or am I just running like crap? And like, right. you have people on both sides of the spectrum that are like ultra delusional, right? The people that think their strategy is perfect and they're just running like crap, and the people that think they're just running like crap, blah, blah, blah. It's all about just being very objective with it. And like you said, you mentioned earlier slightly journaling and like writing all that stuff down. Like that's one of the best ways, in my opinion, to stay objective in it. Otherwise, yeah, it's easy to let this game run you over mentally.
And sometimes I'll take notes and then, you know, I put them away. And then the next day when I look at them, I'll be like, what was I thinking? Like, you know, I thought I played that so well. But then when I look back at it, I'll see something that I think is a glaring error.
Right.
So, you know, you can't really trust yourself in the moment.
Yeah, no, most certainly not. Our brains are not well suited for that. So Chip Extractor says, can you talk about your feelings on hypnotherapy as it pertains to poker, compare slash contrast to your therapy style?
Well, I would say hypnotherapy is excellent. I'm actually certified in hypnotherapy myself, although I took all the training and I don't really do hypnotherapy because I don't really have a good personality for it, because you got to be, you know, calm, cool, and collected, and you have to talk in that soothing voice. You know, it's just really not me.
Right.
But I wanted to learn about it. I think it's a really good idea for people to do, especially if you suffer from tilt a lot, because usually it's something that happened to you long ago and far away that, and then there'll be like a trigger, you know, so like the bullying or the entitlement, you know, things like that. Mm-hmm. If you go through hypnosis, they can bring that out of you so fast.
True.
Like just to find out what it is, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then I can also give you suggestions that will help you hopefully decrease that behavior or even stop doing it.
Right.
Now, okay, I'm a licensed therapist, but with my work with poker players, I don't really do therapy. I do more coaching. And so you might say, well, what's the difference in that? And I'll tell you in just a second. But if you do want to get hypnotherapy, I'm very biased, but I really love Elliot Rowe's work. And I loved his work before I ever knew him, like in any sort of personal way. Before I ever met him, I was like, Elliot Rowe rocks. And, you know, I had bought like his MP3s and stuff, and I did not know who he was. And it's just through happenstance that I met him. Actually, I wouldn't have met him at all if it hadn't been for Jonathan Little. So thank you, Jonathan. But so anybody who wants to get hypnotized, Elliot is your man. Now, psychotherapy tends to be more of a restructuring of the personality. So it's really digging deep into, you know, why you have these issues and, you know, what you can do about them and that sort of thing, which is not what I really do in my mental game coaching. I tend to help people more with finding solutions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, from a psychotherapy standpoint, insight is the thing. It's why do you do what you do? From a coaching standpoint, it's more like, yeah, it'd be nice to know why you did what you did, but do you really need to know if we can get to the solution? Well, no, right? You don't. So I try to help people get where they're going just faster. Like, what is the most expedient way? And a lot of that has to do with helping people get clear on what their goals are and clear on what they're going to do to reach those goals, and kind of helping them set up a structure, and teaching them skills so that they can, you know, manage the tilt. You know, I don't know if you can like 100% eradicate tilt, but you can certainly manage it and put it in its place. Because, you know, I had a really famous player tell me one time, he's like, you know, if you get poked with the stick enough times, you're gonna get mad. That's just like human nature. And I was like, yeah, that's true. You know, you're not just gonna be like Buddha or something.
Sweet,
you know,
Gandhi,
right?
Right.
So that's a whole mess of stuff, and hopefully that helps Chip out a little bit.
Fingers crossed. Let's see what else we got. All right. Reading my mind. James, you look like a quarterback, Andrew Luck. I don't know about that.
Yeah, you got your headset on. It's like Super Bowl Sunday.
I guess. Wasn't really going for that, but that's all good.
You can coach me anytime. You be the, you know, you got your headset on and I'm at the table and you can
I try not to wear these on the table just because they're noise canceling. I can't hear anything outside of them. actually curious about this one. Okay, so Austin Bluff says, the attitude of some players is just poor in general. I sometimes wonder if they have mental issues of their own. Is there a correlation between gambling addiction and personality disorders?
Well, that's like a loaded question. I will tell you my opinion. My opinion is that if you have addiction problems, you often will have personality problems as well. There are many different personality types and disorders. Okay, I don't want to say types, personality disorders. Like there's antisocial personality, there's narcissist, there's borderline, there's all different kinds. Okay, typically what you will see if somebody has an addiction disorder, let's say they're an alcoholic or a substance abuser of some kind. When you remove the alcohol or whatever the substance was, a lot of times they will still have interpersonal difficulties. And, you know, so yeah, it does look like there is something else there, I would say.
Okay.
So hopefully Austin Bluff does not have these issues. But that's just kind of that's what I have seen in my own work. I do not specialize in addicts, but long ago and far away, when I had to see, you know, whoever came through the door, I did get some experience with addicts. It's not my specialty by any means, but I would notice that even when you took the addiction out of it, there were still often characterological problems.
Sure.
So there you have it.
That makes sense. All right. So Chip Extractor is very interested with the UFC thing. So I need to go to the restroom super bad. So I'm going to throw the question out there and you're going to talk like hell about it. That work for you?
Okay.
Okay. And then I'll be right back. So Chip Extractor says, can you talk about some of the UFC guys you've worked with? And then he also follows it up by saying, are you going to attend UFC 189 and the Fan Expo? And then I will be right back in 2 seconds.
Okay. So I don't have nearly as much experience working with UFC and MMA as Elliot does, but my neighbors and my good friends actually own an MMA gym. Well, it's a Brazilian jiu-jitsu gym, actually. But a lot of the guys, you know, they do want to, they don't just study jiu-jitsu for the sole purpose of studying jiu-jitsu. They are studying it because they, want to fight in the UFC down the line. So I do have some familiarity with it. Now, my understanding from Elliot is that there is a big expo in Las Vegas, and this may be the one you were asking about. I'm terrible with numbers in terms of like, I kind of get dyslexic. So I don't know if the 189 is the one that's going to be in Vegas in the summer, but if it is, I know there's one there and it's supposed to have an expo attached to it. And Elliot, myself are planning to attend it. So if you're in Vegas during this time, if this is the one you're talking about, then stop by and see us. We would love to have you. I will say you'll probably enjoy it's, I think we have it slated as our fifth episode where we interview Robert Drysdale, who, as I mentioned, a six-time world champion jiu-jitsu guy. And I think if you're into like the UFC and stuff, you're really going to be interested in what he has to say. He does, by the way, for everybody who wants to know, he owns a jiu-jitsu gym in Las Vegas. And I'm trying to do this from memory, but I think it's Rainbow and Sahara. But he did put out an open invitation for all of us. If we want to come by the MMA gym or the jiu-jitsu gym, it's actually jiu-jitsu. So I think it's the Robert Drysdale jiu-jitsu gym. We can come on by and we can do a workout. And he promised me that jiu-jitsu was for anybody, men, women, children, elderly, infirm, didn't matter. He has something for all of us. So come on by and check him out and check us out if that's the same thing same expo you were talking about.
There you go. You all good
I
with it?
I ran my mouth the whole time, James.
That was perfect. Thank you. Oh my goodness, I needed that. All right. So Austin Bluffs has another thing. He says, I'm fascinated about mental preparation and controlling tilt, but do you advocate purposefully trying to tilt other players and do you recommend any techniques?
I mean, okay, tilt people at your own risk because some people are crazy. Okay, so just realize that. Is it a good idea to get under somebody's skin at the table? Yes. I call it psychological judo, actually. And I love a little psychological judo myself, but I don't really try and put them on tilt. What I try to do is this. I try and say, well, how do they see me? What is it that they want to do to me? And how can I use that against them?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here's an example. It was the river event, and this guy came to my table and he had a lot of chips. He had over 1 million chips when the average was like 400,000. And I had like 400,000. So I was average and I don't have a problem with that. And he looked at me and he had like this look on his face. Like he was salivating. Like he knew he was just going to stick it to me and get my chips. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, okay, I know that he wants to do this to me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make him think that he can do it. And so I set up a couple plays where I would come into the pot and then let him raise me. And then I would meekly fold. So then he believes that, okay, what he's doing is working. And then once I did that a couple times, then bam, I opened up my can on him. So eventually, I guess when he comes to the table with over 1 million in chips, he should have easily made day three, which would be, you know, playing not the final table, but it had been like the last three tables, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
But instead, he fell for my wily trap and I took all of his chips. So I doubled up the first time through him. And then the next time I had enough that I could take what he had left. So I put his 1 million chips in my pile by thinking, okay, how can I use whatever his tendency is against him? Did it put him on tilt? Yes, it did. He screamed, he cussed. You can hear it all over the convention center. Was I trying to put him on tilt? No, I was trying to use what I was given.
Totally fair. Totally fair. So Chris Jam says, I'm beginning to make some really tough, big folds, and I'm really struggling with the feeling of getting robbed. I get a feeling for making the fold, but then those niggling thoughts start. How should I deal with these thoughts?
If you know that the right thing to do was to fold, you just have to fold. What I find is that in players who are not as well developed, they do tend to have that curiosity on the river. And a lot of times they will feel so sure that they're beat and they'll still call just to find out.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to say stop that. And I don't know what your perspective is on it, because I know you're a teacher and you're teaching students. So you probably have something to say about that too.
I mean, just if you know strategically it's a good fold, you just have to make it and move on and not feel bad about it. You know, even if it's one of those spots where you're folding like the third nut flush against the old dude that you know only has a nut flush, like, yeah, it sucks, but he's probably not messing with you anywhere near enough to justify it. So, you know, making a hero fold like that can be okay as long as you know it's strategically sound. If you're really worrying about it, then it could be an ego thing, or it could be that you're not confident enough in your strategy. So I guess you really have to do some introspection to figure out which one it is.
And I would also say, you know, if you do make the folds, you feel like it's the right thing to do, you make the fold, then in your head, you need to say, I did a good job. Because like a lot of times that little voice is going to come up and it's going to be like, well, maybe you shouldn't have folded there. Or maybe he tricked you or he got one over on you. And you need to, you know, you can talk back to yourself. Then that's not crazy. That's good. You could be like, shut up over there. I know I did the right thing. Or you could say, I did the right thing. You know, I'm 75% sure I did the right thing. And exactly. Pat yourself on the back. I mean, I can't say that you made money, but you saved money and you should be glad. Like, you're not just going to light $300 on fire, right? So don't do it at the poker table either.
Yeah, exactly. All right. So that guy's being goofy. Why are we talking about the World Series? Someone asked, what are you a doctor for?
I have a doctorate in criminology, which I don't really use. And I have a doctorate in counseling psychology, which I do use.
There you go. Do-do-do-do-do. Okay, don't laugh on winning players. I think Oh, this one's definitely worthwhile. Okay, so Birdie is wordy, says, okay, don't laugh. I'm a winning player. I only play online. I'm unable to play for long periods as I'm too terrified of losing money. I want to play at higher stakes and feel I can, but have too much panic. Do you have any suggestions?
Well, I would wonder if this was a person who outside of poker has a lot of panic and anxiety. Because if that is the case, then you could definitely look at doing some therapy around that. There are also some medications that you can try. So I would just kind of wonder if that was more of your personality is just more like of an anxious personality, or is it specific to just poker? If it's a global anxiety, then there are some very effective psychotherapies that you can check into using. Particularly cognitive behavioral therapies can work well, and there's some very good medications you can try. But you would definitely want to talk to your physician or a licensed psychologist in your area, you know, somebody qualified to help you with those things.
And what if it's just poker related? How could they work through that?
You should go to Elliot, is what you should do. And the reason I say that is because there has to be something that is triggering you. And I feel like if you worked with Elliot, he can just, because what happens when you're in hypnotherapy is that you're very relaxed and your like conscious defenses kind of go down, and you're not going to cluck like a chicken, so don't worry about that. But when the things go down, it's just you can access things easier, and you can find out what that trigger is for that. And then he can also give you some suggestions to eradicate that trigger. But if it's just for poker, then I'd say try Elliot. If it's overall, then I think you need to try a more global strategy.
Sure, that's totally fair. Blitz says, with card in your name, were you destined to play cards?
I was born for it, people. I
All
just
right.
wish that I would have known about it earlier, you know, because I didn't come to it until, like I said, I never even played cards until like 2006. And if I would have come to it earlier, just think of the beast I could have been.
So
So,
true. But I mean, you got into it still pretty early. Relative, at least you
yeah.
got in the online days.
Yeah, that's true. But unfortunately, all through those years, I was working full time and I was going to school full time. So it wasn't like I could, you know, really be the beast that, you know, some of these people, I mean, they were able to just make tons and tons of money during those years because they had the time to like really play. And me, it was like, oh, I'll play in the evenings, you know, after work, or, you know, I got to write this paper on Saturday, so maybe I can work or I can play on Sunday. So you know what I mean? It was not like I was totally into it.
Makes sense. Totally fair. So, you do have a little ego, says, how do you decide to plan your days as a full-time player, planning hours when you work and improving your game, playing, etc.? How do you even know how to plan essentially what to work on in your game? So essentially, full-time player, how do you prepare a schedule? How do you prepare learning and all that kind of stuff?
Well, I almost feel like you should be the one answering this just because I feel like this is like totally your wheelhouse.
I mean, I'll answer it a little bit, but then I'll let you jump into it. So
Okay.
I've never played full time. I've played as semi full time, I would say, back when I was in college and just out of college. So for me, it was finding the schedule of being able to play, then study, play, study, play, study. And for me personally, I cap out mentally online at about 45 to 60 minutes. So it was play for an hour, study for an hour, rinse, repeat back and forth until I was done for a day. So I think one-to-one study to play is pretty good. As you get much, much stronger, maybe you play for 2 hours for every 1 hour that you study, but I think there needs to be a tremendous amount of study in your game. I think too many players think, oh, I'm just going to go pro and all I'm going to do is play. But if all you do is play, you will get passed up at some point. I'm not going to say it's going to be in a month or two, but you will get passed up if you don't study.
Yeah.
So that's what I would suggest on it. But from like the pure mental point of view, like how would you suggest going about it?
Well, I really like what you're saying about the 1-to-1 and the 2-to-1 because I totally believe that's true. So if he's working full time, then he's going to have to, or she is going to have to, you know, work with that schedule a lot harder to see, you know, so are they working full time? Are they playing poker full time? I guess I'm not.
It sounds like they, it sounds like they want to be a full time poker player.
Well, I would say, you know, being a full time poker player is hard, actually. So think long and hard about that before you, you know, commit to it. Because like James is saying, the inclination for most people is to go and just play. But I feel like what he's saying is absolutely correct. If you are not putting in the work on your game and the study time, you will fall behind. And I feel like you will fall behind in a year or two at the most. And yeah, that's just not going to be any fun. If you're going to play full time though, it's, you know, it's like a job where you have to have a set schedule. And if you're not going to play, you're not going to eat basically. So you just have to think about what are your prime hours? When do you think the best? When are you the clearest? You know, I would be playing in my prime hours and then I would be setting up my study time for, you know, when I'm not as clear or as sharp.
Sure. Would you alternate play and study kind of like what I was describing, or would you personally do it more where it's maybe I'll play for 4 hours and then study for 3 or 4 hours in the evening? How would you break it down personally?
Well, me personally, I watch poker videos all the time. I read books all the time, blah, 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 blah. So I'm doing it just about every day. But I know like Jonathan Little, because he does play full time and I definitely don't play full time, not anywhere close. And I can tell you what I know that he does. He watches videos every day and he does it like in the morning. So before he goes to the tournament or before he goes to play, he will watch an hour or two of videos. And mm-hmm. so, but I think it could be okay to do it afterwards too. It just kind of depends. You know, if I'm the type though, after I play, I'd rather do it early too, because after I play, you know, I'm like tired and I don't know that I'm going to get that much out of the studying.
Sure.
I feel like if you're just passively watching a video too, that's not really what I think James has in mind when he's talking about studying.
Right.
Am I right on that?
Oh, 100%. I mean, if you're going to watch a video, if you're going to read a book, if you're going to do anything studious, it needs to be active. You know, it's not just push play and then just like zonk out and it's going to stick. Like you need to be doing a lot of like active thinking. And you and I have spoken at length about this, but it's really important to have that active element. You know, if it's note taking that helps you be active, fine, but just be active with it.
Yeah. And I think if you're watching videos, be asking yourself, you know, well, why is he or she making that play? Because a lot of times they're not going to tell you, you know, because they just do things automatically because they're so used to it. But kind of think, well, why are they going to do that? And then think, well, what would be the good points to that? Well, what would be the not so good points to that? What else could they have done? Like if you're thinking like that and maybe taking notes on that kind of stuff, that's going to improve your game.
100%. It forces you to be active, which is awesome. So, tough folds, already answered that. It's all over the place. People have to start using like hashtag Q or something like that.
Are we getting hecklers in the crowd or something?
We have a couple of hecklers. I'm ignoring the hecklers.
Well, that's not fun. I thought poker was supposed to be warm and fuzzy.
Yeah, that's the way this game works. If my game is okay, so if my game is perfect, what is the best way to come back from a mental downswing? Lack of confidence, laziness, lack of mental weakness, yada yada.
Wow. I mean, I never had a perfect game, so I don't know that I can answer that one. I wish I had a perfect game, but unfortunately I can always think of things or find things that I need to work on. So I guess if you had a perfect game though, you might get to where you're like, hey, I got a perfect game. I don't need to work.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I think if that happens to you, it's not going to be very long until people are running you over. I mean, poker's just evolving so quickly that you just can't really afford to, you know, just lay on your side or on your laurels, whatever the case may be, you know?
Sure. So I'm going to change his question slightly. Let's say you're like a really, really solid top tier player, right? And you play in high stakes cash games in a pool of like 7 people and, you know, you're super top end. talk about how you would deal with the mental stuff for that kind of player. Like, would you give them the same mental advice that you would give, like, someone who's brand new to poker? Or, like, if that person, if the super high-end player was going through some mental issues, what kind of stuff would you be working with and talking with them about?
Well, I feel like usually the types of tilt differ, okay? When I'm a lower level player or lower skilled player, oftentimes the tilt and the emotional issues come from what somebody did to me. So like they put a bad beat on me or they sucked down on me, you know, it's all that kind of thing. When you work with the high end players tend to beat themselves up. So they focus a lot more on their mistakes, feeling bad about their mistakes, dwelling on it. So it's more inner directed. That's sure. What makes them mad. They get upset when they don't play their best or when they knew what the right move was, but for whatever reason, they didn't do it. Like, you do not get to be in the top tier without having a tremendous work ethic and mental game to start with. Mm-hmm. So that's important to for people to know. You will not get to the top tier unless you work extremely hard and you have to, you know, work on every single edge, because when you get to the top tier, everybody's strategically sound. It's not possible to be there if you're not. So the mental game becomes even more important as you go up levels. But I think the content of what you're talking about is different. What I would say too is that when you deal with the lower end players in the mental game, they're usually like, I don't want to do that, or I don't want to take notes on my hands, or whatever it is, right? There may be some reluctance on their part. You will never see that with the top end. With the top end, they're like, what can I do? And I will do it. And they do it. So that's like a big difference too.
100%. So I'm going to go one step deeper in this one. So you said a lot of them tend to have that inner beating themselves up. How would you, what kind of advice would you give to someone who does that, whether it be in poker or outside of poker? Like, how do you help someone that does that?
I mean, a lot of that is training your brain, because what's happening is those thoughts are popping into your head. We talked about this on one of the videos that we made before. Do you remember, James, it was about that upper limit problem where we sort of have these mental stumbling blocks where, you know, we think this is the level I can get to. And once we start getting close to it, we start like sabotaging ourselves because we're not comfortable going over it. So some of it is helping to increase your ceiling of what you believe is possible for you. So it's just a lot more of, I guess, like a cognitive behavioral transition, if you will. And, but again, I'm going to say if you're top tier, you know, their problems are not, they're just not the same as, you know, lesser tiered players generally.
Sure. That makes sense.
I would also say if you're successful in business, if you're a very successful person in things other than poker, then you can be successful in poker. But if you're not successful in other realms of life, it's hard to be successful in poker. Like, successful people just do things that non-successful people are not willing to do, if that makes sense.
100% makes sense. 100%. That was actually the last question.
Yay.
Other than someone telling me that I don't know how to recycle my bottles. That is false. It's not empty yet. Still a sip.
Well,
excellent. So is there any last minute things you want to chit-chat about, or any other products that I forgot to mention that you want to just talk about real quick?
Well, you didn't mention our product.
I wasn't sure if we wanted to or not. So
I mean,
I'll let you pitch it. It is coming. It should be out within the next 2 or 3 weeks. So why don't you fill people in on what we did and what's coming out?
Well, we made a series of videos. And so it's going to be a package. It's the Mental Advantage. And we discussed, I have the table of contents right here. But we discussed discipline. We did the psychology of expertise and how you become an expert. We have a video on overcoming those mental stumbling blocks, which I mentioned. We did a step-by-step learning video. So that kind of tells you exactly what you need to do to learn and study. So the one on expertise is more of the global how you become an expert. And then the second one is like breaking it down. Like, here's exactly what you do. We did a video on psychology of turning pro and like the good, the bad, and the ugly around that. And of course, a no mental package would be complete without a tilt video. So we did 100%. Run a tilt. So yeah, we did that. We worked really hard on them, and we're kind of at the end stages of rendering and putting them all together. So those should be available soon. What, at splitsuit.com?
It'll be available on splitsuit.com. It'll also be available on redchippoker.com, and that should be available, I want to say, April 1st. Don't hold me to that. We're going to do our best to get the editing done as soon as possible.
But we're going to cross our fingers.
We are. And it was a lot of fun to make, and I think a lot of players will get usage out of it. It's not meant for brand new poker players, but anyone who's like, hey, I'm serious about poker, I want to do something with this game, but I'm not sure where else to go, this is a great starting point for that. So check both of our socials. We'll definitely be giving information out very, very soon about that as soon as we have things to share. And I think that's it. Any other things you want to chit-chat about?
I just want to make sure that people know that they can go to check out the podcast on iTunes. So that's the Mindset Advantage podcast with me and Elliot Rowe. And so every week you're getting free mental game content. And for the most part, the people we are interviewing are very, very top tier, whether it's poker or other things. And so I think you can really learn a lot from this, and it doesn't cost you any money. So that's always fun.
100%. And go follow Dr. Tricia Cardner on Twitter. That way you can get a heads up whenever the next one is released. That's at Dr. Tricia Cardner. And obviously make sure to follow us at redchippoker.com, www.redchippoker.com, or at redchippoker on Twitter for anything else. So we'll be doing more interviews like this. I'm just filling in for Christian. Christian will probably be back, I want to say, later this week or early next. And just follow our social and we'll get more information. But Tricia, thank you very much for hanging out with us today, and we'll talk to you soon.
Thank you, everybody.
Take care, guys.